Hi, welcome to my class. My name is Stan D'Souza, and my class is Beginning Programming a PIC16F1 device in C like a pro. So when you finish this class, you'll be able to create and compile a PIC16F1 project using MPLABX IDE. You'll create and run a simple program using the MPLAB code configurator, and we will use GPIO, timers, some of the peripherals of the PIC16F1, the ADC, the PWM, and the UART, and we'll do an application based on that. And finally, we'll write all the application code that we create today in a state machine-based application style. Okay. The agenda for the class as we go along is we'll talk about the PIC16F1 architecture. Then we'll talk about assembly and C language basics. We'll then step into our first lab where we'll create a project using the MPLABX IDE. Then we'll start off our project and use MCC to blink an LED using a timer 1 and an IO line and using a state machine code. We'll also go to part B then after part A, where we will use a key to start or stop the blinking of the LED. And finally, we'll use the ADC, the PWM, and the UART on the PIC16F1 device and continue with our application process. So the first question is that how many of you have done a project in using a PIC16F1 device? Have you done a project from scratch? Have you done a project using C? If the answers to any of these questions is a no, if all of them are no, then you are in the right class, because that's what we're going to do today. We're going to learn how to do these projects or these tasks today. Okay. So the first challenge is when you start off with the project is you're given a data sheet, which is typically about 200 pages, and it's daunting task. It's a daunting task to read the data sheet and 200 pages of it. You may also be given somebody else's code to work with in your project. And that's also pretty daunting because you'll have to go into the mind of the other person to figure out what he was thinking, or he or she was thinking, when they wrote the code. It involves weeks of learning and coding. And you may finally end up with very buggy code, you know. So this process is not very easy. That's a challenge that we have. So to get over the challenge is what we're going to do today. We're going to learn how to program from scratch. That means absolutely blank project, and we'll learn to start doing our coding from there. We will use MCC, which is MPLAB code configurator, to generate code in C. Okay? Then we will not use the data sheet, but I would suggest that if you do want to read the data sheet, please do, because there's a lot of good information in there, and it'll help you in your process. And we'll learn how to create bug-free code for our class today, or your project. So the first item of our agenda, which is the architecture of the F1 device. So the F1 device is just like a computer. A computer has a CPU. It has input devices like a keypad or a mouse, etc. And it has output devices like a display or a printer. So there's input and output going through a computer. The PIC is nothing more than that. It is also a CPU. You get inputs from it, from a switch, and it has outputs like LEDs, LCDs, motor drivers, etc. And in general, you can think about a PIC16 application as a microcontroller. It's a computer or a microcomputer in your application. It's a small computer which is running your application code. Okay. So some of the challenges when you design a project or send a project is to select the kind of device that you have to use, a PIC16 device. So the first question is, how many I/O lines do you need? So you may have 6, 8, 14. We have a bunch of pin output devices which you can select from. Okay. Then the second question is, what kind of peripherals are you going to use? Definitely, you know, you'll use GPIO. But apart from that, you may use the serial UART, an ADC, an I2C, PWM, et cetera. So those peripherals are required in your PIC16 device that you select. What are the other factors which come into the selection of a device? Room for growth. It's important to know that. So if, for example, marketing comes back and tells you that you need to put some more features in your application, then you need more program memory or data memory. So you need to see devices which have room to grow. And that's what Microchip offers. We have several devices in the same family which offer, you know, twice the memory size which is required, et cetera. So looking at a PIC16 F1 device, very basically, you have the CPU, which is the central processing unit. You have program memory in flash, and you have data memory. The program memory consists of all the instructions, instruction 1, 2, 3, et cetera, et cetera. And these instructions are executed. And what these instructions do is that they manipulate data, which is in your data memory, and the peripherals also are part of the data memory. So that's basically, if you look at the architecture, those are the three components which are there. Okay. The PIC16 device is a Harvard architecture. What's the meaning of that? Basically, in essence, the data memory and the program memory are two separate entities in the PIC16 architecture. In Harvard architecture, that's what you have. So you have two separate memory spaces for program and data. This allows us to have different widths on any of the paths that you have. So you can see right here, the program memory path is 14 bits wide, while the data memory path is 8 bits wide. So by having two of them separately, you can have different widths on them, and then that's what we do. We take advantage of that particular feature of the Harvard architecture. And what that allows us is, it improves the bandwidth operation. By having two separate paths to operate on the program memory and the data memory, it allows us faster bandwidth to execute our instructions. Okay? Now, if you look at a data sheet, any data sheet, you'll see a very complicated diagram showing you the innards of the architecture. Please do not try to read this. What I'll do is, I will break this down into the key elements which are required for us to understand this block diagram. So the first element is the program counter, which is right here. It's a program counter, and it's normally 15 bits wide. The next part is the flash-based program memory, where your program will reside. These are all the instructions required to execute your program. Next is the instruction decoder. So those instructions which are written in your flash program memory have to be decoded, and this decoder will do that job. So that's an important factor. And there's also something called the working register. In many architectures, this is called an accumulator. In our case, we call it the working register. And finally, we have the data memory. And the data memory is what is manipulated by the accumulator. And that's where we store all the peripheral information, et cetera. All the details to configure our peripherals are saved in the data memory. So in the PIC16 architecture, the data memory is what gives it the 8-bit path. And that's why it's called an 8-bit architecture. So how do these five elements interact with one another? So the program counter points to a region in the program memory and picks up the instruction which needs to be executed. Okay? That instruction is then loaded into the instruction decoder, okay? And that instruction is decoded. So what exactly does that? There are a bunch of instructions which are listed in the PIC16 architecture. And each of them does a different function. So the decoder actually decodes that information so that it can be executed. And then that decoded instruction works with the working register as well as the data memory, or both, depending on what type of instruction it is, and then executes some operation. So in general, this is the basic elements of the innards of the PIC16 device that we have. Okay. So the next step now is that we've got to look at these instructions. Remember, the instructions are important to in our flash memory, and they will constitute the program that we write to do certain functions in our PIC16 architecture. So There are two things. One is an assembly language program, and one is a C language program. Let's look at both of them. Okay. So the instructions are in the program memory, and they instruct and they execute one after the other. Instruction one is executed, instruction two is executed, so on and so forth. Okay. So let's look at some of the instructions that we have. Okay. And here's one instruction. But before I go into the instruction, let me explain what the different elements in this slide are. The top is where the instruction is. I'll list the instruction in this top block. I have the working register value, which is in this particular area. And then we have a segment, only a segment of the data memory, or we call it register files. And we have the register files or data memory from address 20 hex to 2B hex. So this is only a segment of it, and we will see how the interaction goes. Finally, we also have the status register. And if the instruction affects the status register, we'll notify you about that, okay? So what does this instruction do? So if you read this instruction, it says move LW. L stands for literal, and literal is nothing more than a constant. Move a constant value into the W register. Move LW, and what is the value of that constant? Literal value is 55. So what this instruction does is that it moves the constant value, which is specified in the same instruction as 55, into the W register. So when you execute that instruction, nothing else happens, but this 55 gets loaded in the W register. This operation will not affect the W register. All right. Similar instructions are move LB and move LP. Okay. Here's another instruction. So how do you read this instruction? It says add the W register to the add the value in the W register to the value in the file register, and you know we'll do something with it. Now, which file register are we talking about? Remember, the file register, there are a whole bunch of them. So the address to the file register is specified by the next numeral, which is 29 hex, which is nothing else but right here, 29x. So the value in the W register, which is 10 hex, will be added to the value in the file register 29, okay, which is 55. And then the result, what will happen to the result? It has to be saved somewhere. So there are two operations can be done. One is that you can save the result in the file register itself, that is this 29 hex, or you can save it in the W register. And that is designated by what is called the designator, which is right here, and in this side, in this instruction, that designator is designated as an F, which is file register. So it'll be saved back into the file register right here. So when you execute the instruction, 10 is taken from the W register, 55 is taken from the file register, and the result 65 is then saved back to the file register. That's what happens, okay? Now this instruction does influence the status byte. So if the operation resulted in a zero, then the Z bit will be set, etc. You know, so it is a very valuable instruction, and you can actually, if you want to save that result into W register, then you could put a comma W here, and it will be saved in the W register. A similar instruction is subtract. You can subtract the value in the W register from the value in the file register and do the same operation. All right, so let's go to another instruction now, and this is a little bit more complicated, but it's a very important instruction. The way you read this instruction is decrement F, skip if zero. That's how you'd read the instruction. So basically what this instruction does is that it decrements the value in the file register, and which file register are we talking about? File register 29. And if the result of that decrement is a zero, then the next instruction will be skipped. Okay? So that's how you would read this particular operation or instruction. So to understand how this particular instruction operates, let's look at some code. You know, the best way to understand is to look at some code. And I have some code which I listed right here, and this particular instruction is embedded in that particular code, okay? So here in this code, what I'm doing is, I'm actually executing a function, getCharacter, which gets character from, say, a serial port. And I'm keeping count of the number of characters I get in 29, which is right here, this file register 29. And as I'm getting each character, I'm decrementing the count, okay, until I get all my values, okay? And then after I'm finished with receiving all my characters from this function getCharacter, I go to print all those characters that I got from my serial port. So that's what I'm trying to do in this particular operation. Okay, so when I execute the first instruction next, call getCharacter, it gets the character. Remember, the value in 29 is 2 at this point. So I go to the next instruction, which is decf particular 1. So from 2, it goes to 1. The result is not 0, okay? So it does not skip the next instruction, but it executes the next instruction, which is go to next, which does nothing more than go to right here and gets the next character. So you get the next character. Now, this time around, when I come to decf, it decrements from 1 to 0, so the result was a 0, okay? So it'll skip this instruction, and it'll go to call print. So that way, you know, this is how you would execute. So it's a very powerful instruction. It's one instruction, but it does a bunch of things in it, and it's very powerful, as you can see. So this particular instruction does not affect the status bit, okay? And a similar instruction is increment f, skip f0. So you can also do an increment, just like we did decrement. You can do an increment f, skip f0 instruction. Okay, so, you know, we looked at a few instructions. We're not going to do all the instructions. There are more than 40 instructions in the PIC16 architecture. We're not going to go through all of them. We just want to get a flavor of the instructions that we have. And you can see from what we did in those three instructions that the PROSA, it's very compact. And it's very fast and efficient, especially the decf instruction. It was extremely effective, actually. But on the con side, it's very tedious, you know. You've got to understand these instructions, how they operate, and, you know, they're not very intuitive. And especially when you want to debug a program, it's very difficult to debug using assembly. So as a result of all these things, it's longer time to market. When you create a code in assembly, generally you'll take a longer time to write the code, you know, because it's not very intuitive, it's kind of like very quirky, and you got to do all kinds of things with it. It's not very intuitive in how to write the code. So in general, what we found is that the alternative is that write the code in C, okay? More and more of our customers are writing the code in C. It's more intuitive. You tend to write faster code, as a result of which you can get your product out faster to your market. And remember, this is very important, because if in case you are the 10th person who made the same product, then your product will not sell as much as the first guy who made it. So, you know, so you're going to be first on the block, first in the market, and as a result of which, it's faster time to market is very important for making your product successful. And then, you know, eventually, remember, even when you write your code in C, the actual instructions are written in assembly. So as a result of which, you know, the compiler does all that work for you. You don't have to sweat the details of how those instructions are decoded. Okay, the compiler does that for you. And, you know, most of our customers tend to use that. Now, 95% of our customers use C to develop their code. This is the information that we get from our customers. Hardly anybody writes their code in assembly. All right. So if you look at C, it's more English-like. You know, you can see an instruction, a simple instruction like an if-then-else instruction. If A equals to the value in B, if the value in A equals the value in B, then you would turn on the LED. LED is on, and the timer 1 is on. You can see that it reads very well. So you know exactly what the instruction is doing. You know. And there's no ambiguity in it. So if this is not true on the end, else, then you turn LED off, and you turn the timer 2 off, okay? So, you know, anybody can look at this and say, yeah, I can understand that. I know exactly what the person is trying to do. So there's very English-like, and it's easy to understand. Here's another instruction. While the value in A equals the value in B, you increment a counter. So this was nothing else than then counter equals counter plus 1. So this is could be 8-bit or 16-bit. It just increments it by 1, okay, while these two are equal. Here's another instruction. If you want to execute some code 100 times, this is how you do it. For I is equal to 1, I less than equal to 100, you increment I, and then you would do that operation. You want to repeat for 100 times. So this operation, A is equal to A plus 1, I, will be executed 100 times. So that's how you do it using a for statement. Okay. So the C language has some values and variables which are defined in it. So a typical value which are character A, and the value for character A is from minus 127 to 128. It's a 1 byte or 8 bits. So that's the value that you can get with that if you declare it as a character. If you declare a variable as an integer, on the other hand, integer I, then the value goes from -27,767 to +32,767. And this is a 2-byte value or a 15-bit value, 8-bit value, with a sign in it. If you say unsigned, that means you don't want any sign to be involved in it, then it's very simple, 0 to 255, and integers are from 0 to 65,535. You can also define them as long or float if you want. Those are allowed by C. Okay, so as I said, when you write code in C, eventually the microprocessor, the PIC16 device, doesn't understand C. It understands assembly. So those instructions that you wrote in C have to be converted to assembly, and the compiler does this for you. So let's look at some of the changes which are involved when you write code in C and transfer it to assembly. So if you define something like variable 1 equals 55, what really happens here? It says move LW, so the literal value 55 is loaded into W register, and that value from the W register is moved to the file register, and the address of the file register which is loaded into is given the address of variable 1. So the value in variable 1 equals now 55 after the execution of these two instructions. So this particular C instruction is decoded in the compiler by these two instructions. How about if variable 1 equals variable 2? That's also an instruction in C. In this case, you will move the value in variable 2 into W, and then move the value in W into the file register, which is a variable 1. So now what will happen is that the value in variable 1 will equals the value in variable 2. So again, one instruction in C, two instructions in assembly. If you use a for loop, for example, the for loop example that I showed previously, where you want to execute an instruction 100 times, you can see for I is equal to 1, I less than equal to 100, I plus plus, and this is what we were doing. You can see you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 instructions are taken, and those then institute or constitute that for loop which is created in C. So all this is done by the compiler. So you don't have to sweat the details. The compiler does it for you, and the compiler is fairly well tested. So you don't have to worry that you did a certain instruction and then you didn't take care of certain issues with the instruction code. The compiler does all that for you, and you have to not worry about it. Okay? So we will develop our code in C. And here's the reason why. You can do structured programming using C. It's logical, easier to understand for the humans to understand. You know, the if-then-else statement, the for statement, these are very English-like languages which all of us understand on a daily basis, so it's easy to understand. It's easier to debug. That's actually a very key core, because if in case you have a problem in your system and you want to go and figure out where that problem is, assembly is like pulling teeth. It's very difficult, you know? So C, on the other hand, you'll get a better grasp of what you're doing, and you'll understand what the problems are. So as a result of all this, faster time to market. Your product will be probably the first or the second on the block, and allow the C compiler to do all the grunt work. You know, you don't have to sweat the details anymore. Okay? And Microchip does offer C classes at Masters, so you can take them and you can be an expert on that. Okay, so here's a break and you know, a knowledge check. Okay, so let's ask this question. The PIC MCU architecture is called Harvard. One, because PIC MCU was designed at Harvard University. PIC MCU has one data and program bus, or PIC MCU has separate data and program memory bus. Number three, okay. So I got the answer, it's number three, okay. So it has separate program memory and data memory buses, so it's faster and it's more efficient. Okay, another question. Assembly language is fast and compact, easier to understand than C, easy to write structured code. Okay, there's only one to it, and that's it's fast and compact, yeah. The other two, C is definitely easier to understand, and you can write more structured codes in C. All right, this is a bit tricky. Writing code in C is fast to code, intuitive, structured, all of the above? Yeah, it's all of the above. It's really very, very good, and you know, it helps you along very quickly. All right, so let's go to our first lab now, and what we'll do in our first lab is we will create a project from scratch. Nothing, there's absolutely, we have a blank page here. So we'll create a project from scratch using MPLabX, okay? So that's what we're gonna do as part of our agenda for today, okay? All right. So first, what is MPLabX, okay? MPLabX is something that Microchip offers, and it's an integrated development environment, okay? It's a environment in which you develop your project, essentially. So it has an editor to edit and write code. You can type in things in there and you can actually edit your code there. It has built-in functions to compile the code. Okay, so once the code is written in C or in assembly, you can actually compile it and you can create hex code which you can download to your processor. It also has a simulator where you can test that code that you have. Okay, so you know, that helps you tremendously to debug your code to a certain degree before loading it into your processor itself. That's a software simulator, by the way. Then it works with debuggers and test, and with that you can debug or test your code. So we have several debuggers available at Microchip, and these, you know, the MPLab works hand in hand with these debuggers, and you can actually, you know, debug your code using that. Finally, it programs the PIC devices and hardware. So finally, you know, when at the end of your project, you want to program your code into a device and give it out to production, that's what it does. And it's free from Microchip. So in our first lab, we will actually open up the MPLab IDE, and you can follow along with me, and you can also use your lab manual for help, and we'll create a blank project for the PIC16F1 18855 device, okay? So here are the actions that we're gonna do for our lab. We're gonna open up MPLabX IDE, we're gonna select a device, which is a 16F188555. Then we select a location to place our project, okay? In this case, because we are at the Masters environment, we will actually create it in Masters 2022, which is a class number, and we have a subfolder that called labs. In that folder, we'll create our project, which we'll call lab one. Then we'll select a compiler, and that's all. Then that's done, and then that's the creation of a blank lab. Actually, we don't have any code at that point, but we will create a blank project. So let's go ahead and actually do that. Okay. So let me open up MPLab IDE. Okay. Okay. And okay. And then we'll create our first project. So starting from file, we'll say new project. Okay. and we will select the standalone project right here. I go to next. And then it says all families, so we can actually type in this column the device that we want, and in this case it's the PIC16F1-18855. So you can see it coming up right here. You can select that, and that's the chip that we're going to use today for our project. Okay, you say next to that. Okay. And now we were supposed to select a debugger, but this particular hardware tool we're using doesn't need a debugger. So we're going to skip this portion and just say next. Now we need to select the compiler, and we're going to choose the XC8 compiler right here. Yeah, and say next to that, okay. And then now we've got to select where that project is going to be. Now, it so happens that I'm at the right place, so I don't have to. So you can, if you want, you could browse and can select the right point, but I'm at the right point right now. Let me just go and say browse, and you could then go and select the right location that you want using the browser, okay? So in this case, we're at the right point, and we're just going to say lab one, okay? And that's it. You say finish to that, and MPLAB will create lab one for you. And you can see right here that it is an empty project. There's nothing in it. The header files, source files are all empty. So you're basically creating a empty lab one, okay? All right. So let's come back to the presentation. So we followed all the actions and we created a blank project. So here we saw we had a blank project, and there was nothing in these files. So there's no header files, no source files, okay? So what we're going to do now, we're going to use MCC or MPLAB code configurator to create code for our lab. So we're going to go to the next step now, where we'll use the code configurator to do our next part of the project. So the summary that we have is that we created a blank project using MPLAB XIDE. We selected a PIC device. We selected a debugger. If in case you had a debugger, you could select that. In our case, we don't have a debugger, so we didn't do that. And we select the C compiler that we're going to use to write our code in. So we selected that also, okay? All right, so part A of our agenda is where we're going to start coding our device, okay? So the simple code that we're going to write today in part A is we'll blink an LED using MCC, that is MPLAB code configurator, timer one to give us our time, and we'll do it in a state machine format. So that's what the objectives are for part A of our lab, okay? All right, so before we go there, the hardware we're going to use is something called the MPLAB Express Evaluation Board. You'll see one in front of you, and it looks just like this. Okay, it's got a PIC16F1885 device right here. Okay, it's got four LEDs right here, D2 to D5. It's got a switch S2 right here. It's got a part, and it's got a USART and USB interface. Okay, and it's powered by this USB power supply, so you don't have to have any additional power supply. This USB supplies a power supply for you. And you can also connect a microbus connection right here in this location for microbus peripherals, okay? This is available at our store for $12, so it's a very inexpensive device. Let's talk a little bit about the device that we're gonna use today, which is the PIC16F18855 device. It's got 8K words of program memory and 1K bytes of data memory. It can operate up to 32 megahertz. Okay, it's a 28-pin device, but 25 of them can be configured as GPIO. Okay, it's got a USART, SPI, and I2C. It's got 24 channels of 10-bit A to D. Almost each of the line, I/O lines it's got can be connected to the ADC, as well as a 5-bit DAC output. It's got 5 capture compare plus 2 PWMs. So it's got quite a lot of 7 PWMs total and 5 capture compare. It's got 3 8-bit timers and 4 16-bit timers. And then it's got a bunch of what are called co-independent peripheral, like peripheral pin select, et cetera, et cetera. Now, these acronyms which I've listed here are all listed in the appendix. I won't go through them because we're not going to use them today. So, but they're all listed in the appendix of my presentation, so you can take a look at them, and you want to find out what they are, you'll see a description of them there, okay? So what is MCC? Remember, we're going to use MPLAB Code Configurator, so we got to talk a little bit about it and say, what is it? It's a user-friendly GUI. It's a graphical user interface, and it has got buttons, edit windows, and selection features. And using those features, you can configure peripherals that they are, which are available on the device, and you can create code to initialize those peripherals, as well as C functions which operate those peripherals. So not only does it create code to initialize the peripheral that you selected, it creates code or functions which you can then call to operate on those peripherals. So that's a very good. And all of this code is tested, okay? And it's commented also. So apart from the fact that it's tested and it's working and hopefully bug-free, and if there's any bug, we'll fix it, okay? That's not a problem. But the good thing is that it's commented also, and you can actually see what it's doing. So this helps us along tremendously because it's already created for you. You can then use it to set up a structured project, you know? And then it also creates a main.c for you. And you'll see today that the code that we've created uses all those features, and it's very helpful for us. Okay. So if you look at what we're trying to do today from a hardware point of view, we're taking the PIC16F1 device, we're using one of the GPIO as an output, okay, and driving that output high to turn on an LED. Okay. And what we'll do is that we'll set the GPIO high to turn it on and set it low to turn it off. And what we'll do also is that we'll set up the timer one for half second rate. It'll give us like a half second count for us, okay? And that half second count will tell us when to turn the LED on and turn the LED off, okay? So that's what we're gonna do today, okay? Talk a little bit about the ports which are available from the PIC micro device. The port pin's output looks somewhat like this, okay? So what does that contain? It contains a latch and a port driver, which is capable of driving up to 50 milliamps at the I/O port. Okay, now that does not mean that you can drive each and every pin at 50 milliamps. Remember, there are 24 I/O pins, and if you drive each of them at 50 milliamps, that's a lot of current, so that's not possible. But the I/O pin, each individual I/O pin, is capable of driving up to 50 milliamps. There are some limitations to the total number of total current that can be driven by the PIC device, and you can look at the data sheet for that detail. But this is a very good capability for the I/O line. When we first started up at Microchip, most I/Os could not drive more than a couple of milliamps. Microchip was the only one which had 20 milliamps. Now we've improved to 50 milliamps. And this helped us to drive LEDs directly. You didn't need a transistor in the output stage to drive an LED. You could drive the LED directly from the I/O line. And that's exactly what we're going to do today. So this can directly drive an LED. Then there's a direction control, or what we call a TRIS register. Okay. So there's a TRIS register which is available for each I/O port, which sets the direction for that particular I/O port to make it look like an input or an output, okay, or both. You can actually switch it during programming, so there's no problem in doing that. Each port has a latch, and you can read-write to the latch. So there's a latch available, and you can either write to the latch or write to the port. That'll create the same effect on the port. But the reading, on the other hand, is very unique. When you read the latch, you'll read the last value written to it. However, when you read the port, you'll read the port value on the pin itself. So that's the difference that you have there. Each of the I/O lines is protected with ESD protection diodes right here. You can see the diodes. And what that does is that when you have an electrostatic discharge, you know, when you walk across a carpet on a cold winter day, and you touch a device, there's that electric discharge which goes, and that's really bad for any device. So all the I/O lines are protected with those diodes, okay? And all the I/O lines default to inputs when you reset the device. When you reset the device, all the I/O lines, no exception, becomes an input. Okay, those which are multiplexed with analog function default to the analog function. Okay. All right. So if you look at the part A, that remember we're going to blink the LED. So if you look at the program now, we looked at the hardware. Let's look at the program. So the program is you'll start, and then you'll configure the RA0, which is the one connected to the I/O line, the LED. We'll make it an output. Then we'll turn it on, and we'll have something called the count, and we'll initialize that count to zero, okay? Then we'll go into a loop right here, okay? And we'll keep checking to see if that count equals 500, because 500 milliseconds or half a second is what we want to do to blink the LED. So if in case it is, then we'll toggle the LED. If it is on, we'll make it off. If it is off, we'll turn it on. So that way, we blink the LED, all right? And then after that operation, we'll again reset the count and we'll go back to counting. Now, where does this particular count get incremented? Okay, that this will be executed in a state machine. And then this count is incremented in the 1 millisecond interrupt. So we'll create count timer one as a 1 millisecond interrupt. And in that interrupt, we will increment count. So every 1 millisecond, that count is incremented by one. That is why when it comes down to 500 red in the main program, we know, yeah, it's done, half a second is done, and then we'll toggle the LED. So in general, these two operations which are executed will constitute our program, you know, that what we want to do in our program, okay? So let's talk about timer one. We are going to use timer one, so let's understand how we use timer one. So timer one is a 16-bit timer, and basically every time you get a T cycle or the internal clock toggles it or increments it, when it increments it, it goes from 1, 2, 3, 4, and then eventually it'll go up to FFFF, and then it'll go to zero, okay? So what timer one does is that you increment it, you reload a value to it, and then you increment it every with the T cycle, internal clock. And once it rolls over from 5FFFF to 00, an interrupt is generated, okay? So that's what it does, and this is exactly what my bullets say here. So if you look at that from the math point of view, you know, what does that constitute? You know, how does that work in from a math point of view? Okay, if T cycle, or the internal cycle, is 250 nanoseconds, and we loaded a value of F060 into our timer one, so the first T cycle, F00, will go to F061. Second T cycle, 62. 399 T cycles goes to FFFF. And you can do the math. I did the math myself. And finally, the next T cycle, the 4000th T cycle, will take it to zero, where, remember, when it goes from FFFF to 00, an interrupt is generated. So the interrupt will be generated. So you can look at the math now. 4,000 T cycles, so 4,000 times the 250 nanoseconds right here equals 1 millisecond. So every 1 millisecond, you will get a timer. So if you load a value of F060 into the timer one and increment it with the T cycle of 250 nanoseconds, you'll get a 1 millisecond interrupt every time. Okay. If you look at it from a visual point of view, okay, I have first T cycle goes to F060, 390 takes it to FFFF, the next one takes it to zero, and an interrupt is generated. Okay. So we get 1 millisecond count, and then in the interrupt, if we increment this count that we have, and when that count equals 500, that equals our half second delay that we want to blink that LED. So that way we can blink our LED. Okay, all right. So let's talk a little bit about interrupts. You know, we didn't talk about interrupts at all. So what are interrupts and how do they work? Okay, so we looked at this diagram before where instructions are executed one after the other, and we are at, say, instruction I. At this point, say, we got an interrupt. Okay, whatever the interrupt was. It could be a ADC interrupt, it could be a timer one interrupt, it could be a UART interrupt, whatever it is. If you got an interrupt, what the processor will do is, it'll actually save the next instruction into the stack, not the next instruction, but the next address of the instruction, instruction pointer into the stack, and the stack will, the pointer, the PC will automatically go to instruction number 4. Irrespective of where you are, it will automatically go to instruction number 4, location number 4. That's the interrupt vector, as we call it. You know, that's where it will reach at that point. Now, at instruction 4, we've got to have the code for our interrupt, or what we call interrupt service code, you know, that we have. Now, the compiler will do all that for you. You don't have to worry about that. And it will create that code at the right location, etc. But that's what exactly happens internally. After you're finished with the instruction, or the interrupt instructions, you have a return from interrupt where the value that you saved or the address that you saved in the stack is then loaded back onto the PC, which is the next instruction, and the next instruction carries on. So in some ways, it's like, you know, we're having a meeting, you know, and then somebody comes into the door and says, hey, the donuts are ready. So we stop our meeting, and then we go out and get the donuts, and then we come back and we continue on at the meeting. So that's the analogy that I would put as to how the interrupt works. So we were doing something along, we got an interrupt, we serviced the interrupt, and we came back and we continued on with the instruction. All right. So what is the usefulness of having an interrupt? What it does is that it allows immediate service of the peripheral. So we had a peripheral that we configured, and the interrupt allowed us to immediately service it. So without any delays, if, for example, if your time-critical items, for example, are very important, and you need to service them very quickly, so that's what you need to do. When you get an interrupt, you leave whatever you're doing, go quickly, do that, what the interrupt requires, and then you can come back and execute your normal code. In general, the interrupts should be kept short, okay? So if you look at the interrupts, in PIC16 architecture, we have the interrupt location at 4, that's it, okay? There's no priority. Every interrupt goes to that location 4. You, as a user, have to set the priority. So for example, if the ADC interrupt is more important than the timer one interrupt, then structurally, when you create your project, you should put that as code higher up in the interrupt structure rather than low in the interrupt structure, okay? There's one global interrupt enable, which basically enables all interrupts, okay? And that gets zero when an interrupt occurs. So within an interrupt, you won't get another interrupt. Only when you return from the interrupt will you be ready for the next interrupt. And there's also something called the peripheral interrupt enable, which allows all the peripherals to interrupt you. There are some which are linked to that peripheral interrupt enable, some which are not. But in general, you've got to enable this interrupt to get an interrupt, you know, this interrupt enable. And beside that, each interrupt has its own enable bit. For example, timer one has a interrupt enable bit. ADC has its interrupt enable bit. UART has its interrupt enable bit. So each of them has an interrupt enable. So you can selectively disable some interrupts or enable some interrupts as you go through your program and as you wish, you know, basically. So an example for timer one is that you have come something called a timer one interrupt enable and a timer one interrupt flag. When the interrupt occurs, this will be set, and this has to be set by you in order to vector to that location number 4. Otherwise, it will not occur. Okay. Now remember, all the decoding is done by MCC. MCC allows you to select whether you enable that interrupt, disable that interrupt, etc. Where you're going to put it in the interrupt structure, etc. MCC helps you to do that. Okay. So what is the use of an interrupt? Again, it's a quick indication that a peripheral completed its task. In this case, for example, we got that 1 millisecond. 1 millisecond is over. It's saying that's over. So you've got to go and service it. So it's an important indication that something was completed. ADC may be complete and an interrupt occurs. So you can then go and get the ADC value that you wanted, et cetera. You have to keep interrupt code as short as possible. You know, interrupts are only there to tell you that something occurs. You shouldn't dwell too much into the interrupt code and do a lot of things in the interrupt code. Otherwise, what the functions will go crazy. Just take the example of the donut, you know. If in case we are having a meeting and, you know, somebody came and said, donuts are ready. And then they said, OK, sandwiches are ready. And so every time if you get an interrupt, we will never have a meeting. You know? So that analogy still works. And, you know, that kind of helps us to understand that you shouldn't get, spend too much time in the interrupt routine, you know. Otherwise, you'll never get your work done. So basically, if I would give a suggestion is that you should service the peripheral or service the interrupt, you know, set a flag, whatever is required. And then in the regular task function, in the regular program, you look for that flag and say, oh, yeah, this occurred, so let's do whatever we had to do in that particular peripheral structure. Okay, and then use the state machine coding to service the task that is required. All right. So let's talk about state machines. You know, what are state machines? So state machines initially always have an init in them, okay? And then from the init, you go to a stable state, which is called, in our case, it's state number one. That's the stable state that you have from your structure, okay? Then what happens is that from your state one, an event one may take you to state two, an event two may take you to state three, an event four may take you back to state one, okay? Or an event three from state two may take you to state one. So depending on various things, so basically in your mind or in your structure, when you create these state machines, you've got to figure out how many states you're going to have in that particular application, and then develop your state machine based on that. Okay? Just to give you an example about the blinking LED, we have an init, which takes us to a wait state. Now, what are you doing in the wait state? You're looking for the 500 millisecond done, right? So we're looking to see, oh, is that half second or 500 millisecond flag done? You know, is it done? When it's done, it goes to the blink LED, where you do nothing else but if it is on, you turn it off. If it's off, you turn it on. And then you go back to waiting for that 500 millisecond delay. So there are only three states, the init state, the wait state, and the blink state. That's a very, very simple state machine. But yet, it's an important way of doing it. So you can see that's all that's required in the logic out here. Okay. So in a state machine, you may have in an application, when you develop your entire project in an application project, you may have a bunch of state machines. You may have an LED state machine. You may have a key press state machine. You may have a UART state machine, etc. And then what you do is that each of these state machines operates one after the other. Now remember, in these state machines, none of them is holding tight to the CPU. You know, each of them is doing something in that state and going to the next state machine. That's something the LED state machine does something, passes it on to the key press state machine. Key press state machine does something, it passes on to the UART, and then it'll keep repeating it. So as a result of each one of those state machines is getting serviced. None of them has got control of the CPU. Everyone is getting serviced at a particular time, you know, time rate. Okay? And that allows all state machines to execute in the main loop. Okay? And all parts of the application get serviced. That way there's no something called blocking code. That's the worst thing that you can have, you know? Something that blocks your code, you know? That's terrible. All right. So here's how it would look like. If you have your main program, you would do a system initialize, then you would initialize all your state machines, application LED, application key, application UART, and then in the main loop, you would run each of those state machines. You'd do the application LED tasks, application key task, and the application UART task. So you'd execute each one of them, and you'll continue doing this forever and ever. So as a result of which, each one of your functions is getting operated on. Nobody is taking full control. The interrupt works separately and gives input separately, depending on whether the LED needs some interrupt or the UART needs some interrupt. So that's being done separately, okay? But everyone is happy and everything is working in harmony, okay? So to execute a state machine coding, okay, what is called a switch case instruction, which is available in C, is very, very useful. Okay, and here's how the switch case instruction works. It works as switch a variable, which in this case is called letter. Okay, and if in case that letter is an A, then you say printf letter A found. Okay, that's what you would do, and then you would break. Then you'd say case B, where if that letter equals B, then you say letter B found, and you'd break. And then you look at the next one, which is if that letter equals C, that means the same letter equals C, then you'd printf letter C found. And the default is, if it's not A, B, or C, the default is print letter is not A, B, or C. So that's how you do it. So the switch case statement is very important to go from one state to the next state to the next state to the next state. So in your typical state machine, you could have three states, four states, five states, depending on what you want. But you can have that switch case statement to go through each one of these states. None of these states hold the CPU to itself. They do whatever is required and then just get out of there. You know, they give the CPU time back for the next execution of the statement. Okay, and it's excellent. The switch case statement is excellent for use in a state machine coding. Okay, so here's what it'll look like. For example, in our LED state machine coding. So we have the switch app LED state, so the state of that particular LED that you have. We have the init state, wait state, and the blink state. So in the init state, you do nothing else but go to the wait state. In the wait state, you're looking to see if that timer count that we had is greater than or equal to 500. Is it equal to half a second? If it is, then you go to the blink LED state, and you zero out the counter. That means you reinitialize the counter. And in the blink state, you toggle the LED, and then you go back to the wait state. So this state machine executes everything that's required for blinking our LED that we have. Okay. One small hardware issue that I'm going to talk about is the programming of this particular board that we're going to use today. That is called the programming of the Express board that we are going to use, the Express PIC MCU. So this board, the way it functions is that it functions as a self-programming MCU, okay? When you connect it to the PC, and we have it connected to the PC through a USB right here, okay, it will show up as a, you know, F drive, you know, as a driver, okay? And as a flash drive, you know, it shows up as a flash drive. And what we have to do is that we have to load our MPLAB IDE properties with this particular instruction, okay? And please remember this instruction if you can, okay? As we go through the process of doing it, I will actually show you. But it basically, we have to execute this after build, and you know, and it says copy over the image of the hex file over to the F drive in our case. And then that will then automatically program the PIC which is there on this particular device here, okay? And all we have to do is that once we've done this particular operation in that build, then we do a clean and build, and automatically this is executed and the hex file is loaded into this particular device and it'll program it at that point, okay? All right, so in part A of our lab, which is what we want to do, we want to blink an LED. You can follow along with me. We will use you can use a manual also. We will actually use MPLAB code configurator, and we will blink the LED using MCC and the state machines. So here's the actions that we're going to do. We're going to use MCC. We're going to configure timer 1 for a 1 millisecond interrupt, and we're going to set RA0 as an output D2, which is the designator for that particular I/O pin. And we'll generate code, okay? Once we do that, we will actually edit the code which is created for timer 1, that's the interrupt code, and we'll use the callback function to increment the count, okay? And what I've made it easier for you to do is that at the bottom of each of the app.h files, okay, we have all the code that is required, and you can cut and paste those, okay? Then we'll include something called the app.h application header file and the application c file. This is the code that I have written in the state machine format, and you know, we'll go through that as we are doing the application, and we'll include that into our project, and we'll study it. We'll study as to what they are doing. And then in main.c, we'll enable the global interrupt, because remember, we've got the timer 1 interrupt set up, so we need to enable the global interrupt and the peripheral interrupt. The timer 1 is a peripheral, so we've got to enable both those bits. And then we've got to call the initialization and the task routines which are required in the main function. And we'll compile and run the code. So that's what we're going to do right now. So let's get out of our presentation, and we'll go to MPLAB, okay? So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to click on this icon MPLAB code configurator. We'll click on it, okay? Okay, and now we've got the code configurator. You can see there are various icons which are there listed here to set up the functions which are required. The first thing we're going to do is to select the oscillator or the clock required for our application. So in this case, we're going to select 16 megahertz, and we're going to do clock divide of 1. We're not going to do anything more than that. Okay, that's all we need to do there. And then we're going to select the I/O for our the RA0 for the I/O line. So RA0 is right here. We want to configure it as an output. So you can see GPIO pin module RA0 port A0. We select that as a output. Okay, all right. So having done that, now let's go to timer 1. So we want to select timers. So timers are right here. We go down just a little bit and select timer 1. So we double click on it, and we select timer 1. Okay. So the input to timer 1 is FOS divided by 4. Okay. And then we're going to leave everything as it is. And then here we're going to type in the period that we want, and we can just select 1.0 milliseconds, okay? And we select that, okay? Then we're going to also select the interrupt. So we want the timer 1 to interrupt. So we're going to enable the timer 1 interrupt and the callback function. That means we're going to have something called a callback function, and that occurs every 1 millisecond in this case. So every time we have an interrupt, we have a callback function executed, okay? So with that, and then finally, we go back to the spin module, okay? So we're going to name this, we're going to custom name that to D2, okay? Now, it says here it's an analog pin. By default, it's an analog pin, so we want to remove that. We only want to keep it as a digital pin, so we're going to deselect the analog function. So it's an output, straight I/O output, not an analog output, and it is designated as D2, all right? So with that, we'll generate our code, okay? So we say generate code. It asks you to whether it wants to save the file. It says save, and that's completed, okay? Now the code is completed, which the MCC generated for us. Now let's go to the application itself and see how it looks, okay? So if you look at lab 1, you can see that the header file has something called MCC generated files. So all the MCC generated header files are created for you, but the user application, nothing has been done as yet. And in the source file also, you'll see the main and you'll see MCC generated files. So what we're going to do is that I have created code for you, and instead of you typing, I've created this code and kept it ready for you. We'll just include those files over in our project, okay? In order to do that, we'll go to the Explorer, okay, and we'll go to C, Masters, and the class number is 2022, okay, and in support, under support, I've got part A, part B, part C. So open up part A and select both of these files, okay, and you can right click your mouse and say copy, and then copy them over to our lab, okay, which is right here, and paste. So now we've included this, the application header file and the application C file to our project, and we will now go to the project and include it in that, okay. So let's go back to MPLAB IDE, and under header files, right click there and say add existing item, and select the app.header file. The header file is loaded in the header folder, okay. Then go to the source files and right click and say add existing item, and then select the application source code, okay, C code. So now we have included both those files also, okay. Now you can actually take a look at these. If I open up application.c code, okay, you can see that there are a bunch of things which I've created. Now, right now you'll see a lot of errors, but let's go back to it later on, and then we'll see how that includes. So before we go there, let's edit the timer1 seek file. Timer1 C file, okay, to include certain things, okay. So we'll go down to include file right here and say pound include app.h. So what we're saying is that timer1, you need to have this app.h file, header file, in your include statement. And then we'll go further down, okay, where the interrupts occur. Oops. Okay. A callback function right here. In the callback where you can add your custom code, and here we'll add something. We'll say app LED data dot what happened here? App LED data dot timer count plus plus. Okay. Okay. And then we'll go to main.c. And in main.c, we'll do the same thing also. We'll actually go down to this location, found include app.h. Okay. And then we'll go into the main system, and we'll include all that is required right here. The first thing we need to do is say app LED initialize. And then go down a little bit further, and then enable, remember we said enable the global interrupt and the peripheral interrupt. So all we have to do is remove the commented sections here, and that will enable those two functions. And finally, we will add in the while loop, we will call our state machine, which in this case is app LED tasks, okay? So that will complete what we require in our state machines. So if you look at app.c, okay, so app.h. This is weird. I'm having some problems here. Sorry about that. Okay. All right. So we've got everything loaded up there. So let's go to the final stage, which is the properties. And in properties, we're going to enable in building right here and execute this line of code after build. And that's nothing else but copy space slash y space dollar open curly bracket image path close curly bracket backslash output dot hex. Okay. So that's what we're going to execute after build. We say apply and say OK. All right. With that, let's do a copy and build right here. Okay, so that was executed, and if you can see in front here, you can see that that LED is blinking at a half second rate, which we have here. That D2 LED is blinking at the half second rate. So it's successfully built and everything, and executed the code, okay? Now, if you want to take a look at the code, you can see that the code is right here. And let's see what we did in the code, okay? So in the code, right here. Now, in the code, we had LED initialize, so LED state initialize, and we did nothing else but set the initial state to init. Then we went down, okay, and we had the task itself, so we had the various tasks. One is the LED state machine, the wait state machine, or the state rather, and then finally the blink state okay? So in the wait state, we do nothing else but look for the timer count, which is the count that we are keeping. Is that equal to 500? That is the half second delay. If in case it is, then we go to the LED state blink, where we toggle the D2, and you know that is executed, all right? All right, with that, we finished the part A. We got that blinking LED at a half second rate that we can see right here being executed. All right? So let's go back to our presentation. Okay. So what did we accomplish in part A of lab one? We used MCC to configure timer one as a 1 millisecond interrupt, remember? And then we called back, we had a callback function in which we incremented count, okay? Then we used a state machine for the coding. So it was a very simple state machine which had nothing else but init, wait, and blink. That's it, very simple state machine. But in that state machine, we blinked the LED at a half second rate. And we executed this code and we got the code working, all right? Okay. A word about the 1 millisecond. Why did I pick a 1 millisecond timer tick? Okay, I could have taken a 500 millisecond, timer tick. But it's important because in 1 millisecond, okay, if the pick, you remember the pick is running at a 16 megahertz, that's the clock that I selected, we could execute 4,000 instructions in that 1 millisecond. So by the time that interrupt occurred the second time, in that interim period, I could execute nearly the entire program memory of the PIC that we are talking about. 4,000 instructions, you know. So, you know, it's a lot of code that you can execute in a 1 millisecond, you know, and there's no problem of executing that code. So as a result, you know, this was a very simple example that we had, but even if we had a more complicated example, we could execute a lot of code, 4,000 instructions. That's a lot of instructions in that 1 millisecond. So the 1 millisecond tick is very important. It's very useful, you know, in a system. You know, you can use that same 1 millisecond, for example, to update LEDs or LCD displays. 5 milliseconds are required, 5 of those counts. And to sample a multiplex keyboard, you need 50 to 100 milliseconds. That can be done with using that 1 millisecond count. So it's a very important 1 millisecond timer tick, as we call it. Okay, all right. So let's go to the next part of our system, or part B, okay, where what we want to do is that we want to put one more peripheral into the mix now. And this peripheral is a switch, okay? We have a switch available on this particular board, okay? And what we're going to do is that when we press the switch, press and release the switch, that means when you push it, when release it, we want to stop that blinking LED from blinking. And then when you press it again, we want to start it up back again. That's what we want to do. That's what we're going to do with the key press start stop blinking of the LED. Okay. So if you look at it from a hardware point of view, you have your GPIO driving the LED. Now we configure another GPIO as an input from that S2 switch that we have. Okay, and then we have a pull up on that particular switch. So when you press that switch, this GPIO will go low, otherwise it'll be held high. Okay, so first key press will stop the blinking of the LED, second key press will blink the LED back again. Okay, and what is the key press? Basically, when you press and then release the key. All right, that's what we're gonna do. So the state machine for that particular, this particular operation is very tricky, okay? Normally, the level, the voltage level on that I/O pin is a high. So when you press the key, it goes to a low, all right? So we can have a high state, which is right here, which is the default state. When you press the switch, there's a low state, okay? But what happens is that because of the physical nature of the switch, right? There is an area when there's a transition between the high and low. And that particular area is where the mechanical switch kind of bounces around a little bit. And it's called the debound state. So that state is basically, it's an undefined state. It could be low or high, depending on what that mechanical switch is doing. So what we typically do is that we actually cause a delay in that state, and that's how we do. So to get over that debound state, we cause a delay. That's what we do. And so we have three states. One is the high state, which is the default state. One is the low state, which is when you press the key. And then the interim state, which is the state of debounce, which goes from high to low, as well as from low to high. So these are the three states, as well as the inner state. So four states altogether need to be defined for a key press. Okay. And how do these four states interact with one another? So you have the init state, which is always there. In all state machines, you have to have an init state. And the init state goes to the default state, which is the high state in this case. When a key is pressed, high to low transition, it goes to the debound states. You delay for a certain time. In our case, it's about 20 milliseconds. And then, depending on whether the level is high or low, it goes to the low state or the high state. Okay. So when you press it down, you go through the debound state, and then the level is low, so you'll go to this particular state. When you release the key, the transition will be from low to high. You'll come back to the debound state, okay? You'll delay for 20 milliseconds, and then remember you release the key, so the level will be high, so you go back to the high state. So this point right here is where you will say, oh yeah, a key press occurred at this level, at this transition right here, okay? So that's how you would see that a key press occurred, a valid key press. Okay. All right. So what are the actions that we're going to do in part B? We're going to use MCC and configure RA Fry as a key press, and we'll name it S2 because that's what the designator is. We'll generate code. Then we'll edit the timer 1 to take the servicing of the debounce time. So the debounce time is 20 milliseconds, and we have a separate count that we keep for the debounce, okay? And that's what we'll do there, okay? And then we'll include some new code, app.h and app.c, which will include the coding for the key press as well as for the blinking of the LED. And that's what we will include in our new project. We'll initialize and run the key task in main.c, and we'll compile and run the code. That's what we'll do in the part B. Okay? So let's do that. Okay. We'll go back to our lab. All right. And we'll go to MCC code configurator. Okay. And we'll look at the I/O lines. Remember, the first thing we need to do is to go to the pin manager. And RA5 right here, you can see RA5, we will make it an input. Okay. All right. Now the pin manager comes up right here. So we'll edit that and we'll call it S2, I beg your pardon. Okay. And that is an input. Okay. RA5 is an input and it's designated as S2. That's all we need to do. And then we'll generate code for that. Okay. We'll generate code for that. Okay, so it's already generated. It does it really quickly. We'll go to our project. Now remember the app.h and the app.c file that we had is for our old project, part A. This is part B. So we've changed the code a little bit, and I've written the code for you so you don't have to spend your time writing it yourself. And we can actually go through the code so you can see what I've done in that, okay? So we'll remove the existing app.h and app.c file. So we just right-click on the app.h and say remove from project, and then go to app.c, right-click on that, and say remove from project, okay? So we'll remove those two projects. Then we'll go to Explorer, MPLAB Explorer. We will go to support, part B, and we'll copy both these files over, say copy, and we'll copy them in our lab. Okay? And we'll say paste, and we'll say copy and replace. Okay? So we replace the old app.c and app.h, the application header and C file, source file, with our new application source code. Okay. Now we've got to include it in our project, so we'll go back to our project, and in the header, we will say actually add existing item, app.h, select, and then come back to the source file and say add existing item, app.c. Okay? All right, okay. Having done that, let's take a look at the timer1. In timer1.c, we got to include, we got to include the, in the callback function, we got to include some code. So in this case, what we're going to do is say, if app s2 data dot state equals app key state debounce. Okay. So if the state is in the debounce state, the key state is in the debounce state, then what we're going to do is we're going to increment another counter, which is app s2 data dot debounce count. We can call it debounce count plus plus. Okay. So basically what we are doing is that if we are in the debounce state, then we have another counter which is counting up to 20 milliseconds, which will cause that delay, that debounce delay that we want in our application. That's what we are doing right here. Okay. So with that, okay, we go to main.c, okay, and we include the two the functions that we want. Remember, we have to always include the initialization of the state machine right here. So app s2 initialize, okay, and then come down here and say app s2 task. Okay, so both the initialize and the actual state machine, we've got to execute those two, otherwise it'll not work, you know? Yeah? So with that, all we have to do is to build now again, clean and build. And you see, after does it that, it's loaded, and it's loaded right here. And you can see that the LED is blinking. When I press S2, it'll stop blinking. And oops, what am I doing? Oh, sorry, wrong button. So when I press S2, it'll stop blinking. And I press it again, it'll start blinking. So you can see, it's stop, start, stop, and start. Okay. So it's working. So, you know, so let's take a look at our code a little bit to see what we did in that particular state machine, okay? So if you look at app.c, where all our code is written, okay, we'll go to the LED code is still the same. We didn't change anything there except, of course, starting and stopping of the blinking. But in the S2, the key state, here's what we did. We had the init state, where we went directly to high or low, depending on what it was. And then in the high state, we look for a change, a transition, going from high to low. So we looked at low. And if in case we did that, we went to debounce. So in debounce, here's what we did. We looked for the debounce count 20 milliseconds. That means, has that delay being over? If in case it was over, then we got the status. If it was low, then we went to the low state. Else, we went to the high state. And remember, at that point, the valid key press is executed. So then we stopped or started the blinking of the LED. And that's what we did right here. If LED was in the stop state, then we went to the start state, etc. And we blinked LED at that point. Okay, so that's what we did right here. And that's all the code for that we executed. And in the low state, we look for a transition from low to high for the release of the key. Okay. All right. So we got that working. So let's go back to our presentation now. And so here we are. That's what the actions are. So a summary for our what we did in lab one, part B, we used MCC to configure RFI as an input. Remember, that's an input for the switch. We named it S2. And in the callback function, we serviced the debounce count. So in that 1 millisecond, we incremented that debounce count for that 20 millisecond delay that we want for the key press. Okay, and we added the state machine for the key press. And then in the main program, we call the key press state machine. And then we start, you know, we saw that it started and stopped the blinking of the LED. Okay. So we achieved what we wanted in the first two parts, okay, that we had. All right. So in part C, what we're going to do is that we're going to step it up a lot more, and we're going to include three peripherals in our application, okay? And they are the ADC, the PWM, and the UART. So it's quite a lot, so let's see how we're going to do that, okay? So here's what the hardware looks like. Remember, these two were always there. We had the LED and the switch. We had it in part A and part B. Now we're going to add these in part C. So the PWM, what we're going to do is that the output of the PWM, we're going to connect to the D3 LED. And what we're going to do is that the value of the pot will be loaded into the PWM duty cycle. So as a result of which, what will happen is that the pot will be like controlling the intensity of the LED. So as you turn that pot, it'll go from a low intensity to a high intensity. So depending on the value of the pot. That pot will be connected to the ADC, okay? And you'll get a value from it, you know, and that value will be loaded in the PWM output. Finally, we have the UART. We'll configure the UART for 9600 baud. And what we'll do is that we'll sort of connect it to TeraTerm, which is the terminal program on your PC, and when you press H on your keypad, it'll say hello world, and you press capital A on your keypad, it'll give you the value of the pot, ADC value. Okay, that's what we're going to try to do with the hardware that we have in our device. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about how the ADC works on the PIC16F1 device. So this is the block diagram of what is called the ADC on our PIC16 device. Okay, this hardware is connected on the PC on the hardware itself right here. Okay, and that pot is connected by a switch into the input, and that has to be done by the user. The user has to write code to connect this pot onto the input pin. Okay, the reference is connected to VDD in this case. That means all the voltages are referenced to the 5 volts just supplied to the device. All right. Okay. So when you use software, you can connect this part directly to the input pin of the ADC. And in the input pin, you can see there's a sampling cap which is there. And that is normally always connected to that input pin, okay, by default. Okay. So when the user executes a go equals one, the internal capacitor is disconnected and the conversion starts. This SAR converter starts doing its function to convert the value on that sampling cap to a digital value that is required. So after 10 TAD, or there's an internal clock which works, you know, and that actually converts the analog voltage to a digital value, and then it creates an interrupt if you include the interrupt, or tells you that the ADC is done, that the conversion is done. Okay, and after that also loads the result of the conversion, the 10-bit conversion, into the ADRES and the ADRES low sample. So this is how the internal working of the ADC operates in the chip. Okay, now the result that we have is a 10-bit result. How is that saved into the registers on the PIC device? So it's a 10-bit result, and there are two 8-bit registers, one called ADRES high and ADRES low. Okay. Normally what happens is that these 8-bit registers, the default value is always left justified. So the low value is from here to here. This is the high bit, this is the low bit, but it is what is called left justified. Okay. Now in C, you know, we normally don't like to use, we like to use integers and all that stuff, which are normally right justified. So when you define ADC as an integer, okay, so you'd want to have it right justified, otherwise it'll make no sense for the C compiler. So in that case, what happened is that we'll actually use what is called right justified, where everything will be shifted over. Now this is the least significant bit, and this is the most significant bit. This makes more sense for the C compiler to take the value and represent it as an integer. Okay, so that's what we're going to do. We're going to actually create a right justified structure. So when we look at MCC, we will use the clock, the internal clock, say FRC, and we will right align the result. So normally the default is left, but we will right align the result. Okay. So the other part of it is the ADD conversion. So the way that I did the ADD conversion was, I have the init state and I go to the next conversion state. Okay. So next conversion basically means it initiates another conversion, and then it waits for the conversion to be done. However, I do 16 conversions for every conversion that I want to use. So I don't just take every one conversion and I use it. I average out 16 conversions. So in my weights function, I look for 16 conversions done. I have a counter for 16, and I look for 16 conversions done. And if they're not done, I go to the next conversion. So I keep doing that till 16 conversions are done. And once I get 16 conversions, I then average those 16 conversions to the value I want. I just shift it over 4 times, and I average the value that I got. So that way what happens is that, you know, if I use every value that I have, I'm not averaging it out. Averaging is a very, very good thing of figuring out if there's any, movement errors in your pot, etc. It's very nice to do it, actually. So I would always suggest averaging out. Even if you do 4 averages, it's fine. You know, I did 16, which is a bit of an overkill, but it's possible. So you, once you get the 16 values, then you initialize the PWM back, and then you start the whole process again. Okay? And then you load the PWM duty cycle with an average value of those 16 that you had. You had 16, you shifted by 4, right here in C, and then you load that value into the PWM. Okay? All right. So let's look at the next peripheral that we're going to use, the PWM. So let's look at how the PWM works on the PIC16F1 device. So the basic block diagram for the PWM is a duty cycle register and a period register and a SR flip-flop, okay? And that is connected to the output, okay? We use timer 2 as a timer which actually is looked on or compared to the duty cycle as well as the period register. So timer 1 is incremented by the internal clock, and as it's incremented, you know, the value of the output is first high, okay? And at every time the timer 1 increments, the value is compared to the value in the duty cycle, okay? When the two are equal, the output reset pin is set high, and as a result of which the output goes low. Reset means goes low, okay? So normally it was high, okay? And as the value in the duty cycle register equaled the value in the timer 2, it got reset to low, okay? At the same time, it also gets compared to the value in the period register. And when those two values are equal, the set value gets set, and the value goes now from low to high, okay? So, and the timer 2 gets reset to 0, and the whole cycle is repeated all over again. So in order to look at the duty cycle, there's something called the period, which is from a one high transition to the next high transition. And then this calls the duty cycle, which is right here, which is from one high to one low. Okay. So what happens is that when you load a value in your duty cycle register, this duty cycle goes from 0 to 100%. Okay, from 0% to 100% of the period. The period is never changed, but the duty cycle is changed. As a result, you know, the two are compared, and then, you know, they go from 0% to 100%. Okay, so what we're going to do is that we're going to use timer 2, and we're going to select the clock as FOS, internal clock FOS divided by 4. And then in the PWM, we're going to enable the PWM, and set the timer, set the input as the timer. That means the one that is comparing the duty cycle and the period register as timer 2. Okay. Finally, let's look at the UART. The UART is also a function in the peripheral, and how does that operate in the PIC16 device? Okay. So if you look at the internal of a RAD, if you break it up to the simplistic format, we have something called the baud rate generator, okay, which has all the functions for the clocking of the UART, okay? Remember, this is a asynchronous reception, receive and transmit, right? So you have something called the receive serial register and a transmit serial register, which actually does the receiving and the transmitting, okay? But you have also registers called TXREG and RXREG, which the user can use to load values to be transmitted or received, okay? So when you receive all the 8 bits, they put it into the receive register and so on. Let's see. So when you, the baud rate generates all the clocking which is required for these registers. From the receive pin, serial data comes in and it's received in the receive register. When all the 8 bits are received, those are loaded into the RC reg, and the flag is generated saying that, oh, I've received the 8 bits which are required in the serial input. And the user then can just go then and then retrieve the information from the RC reg. When you want to transmit something, the TXIF should be empty. That means there's nothing in the transmit register. And then you load something in the TREX register. Okay, that automatically gets loaded into the TSR, which is the transmit serial register, and that gets pushed out to the transmit pin. Okay, so that's what we do is as to transmitting and receiving using the UART block. Okay, so in the setup, we will enable transmit, we'll enable continuous receive, and we'll use the standard I/O for the UART. That is the print function. Instead of going to a printer, it'll actually go to the serial port and transmit it serially or receive serially. Okay. So the UART state machine will look something like this. You have the init state, which goes to a wait state. When the character is received, you get the character, you decode what the value is. Remember, when you got an H, you'll transmit a hello world. When you got an A, you'll transmit the value of the ADC. So that's what you want to get in the receive buffer. You want to receive a H or A. If you get anything else, it doesn't do anything. It just ignores it. Okay. And then here's what you send out. When you get an A, you send the ADC value. When you get an H, you say hello world. Okay. So that's what the state machine does. Okay. The final block diagram, because of the way the IOs are configured on this particular board, we have to reconfigure them. And we use something called the peripheral pin select to redirect certain IOs which are there on our device, you know, that we have, and depending on the board that we have. The peripheral pin select is very useful in the sense that it actually helps us to change digital I/O to different pin outputs depending on what you wanted to achieve, you know. So in this case, we want the PWM output to go to RA3 because the LED is connected to RA3. So we redirected it here, okay. Then we want the analog pin is the analog pin. It's connected to the port and you just select that right here. The transmit and the receive are normally on the port C pin number or bit number 6 and 7, we want to redirect them into these two bits, that is 0 and 1. So that's what we want to do. So we'll use the peripheral pin select right here, this peripheral pin select feature on this particular device to redirect some of our digital I/O to the IOs of a different value, you know, or different location. This is basically to accommodate the hardware that we've got, you know, that helps us a lot. It's very, very useful having this peripheral pin select feature on this particular PIC, okay? But remember, you can only change digital peripherals only, okay? All right, so the PWM is redirected, the UART is directed, the SPI can be, we are not using it right now, and the I2C also can be, okay? So this allows flexibility for our PCB design, so if we designed, this is a very classic example, this PCB was designed with that, you know, those particular features, so we could redirect them properly, you know? All right. So this is what our final I/O setup will look like. I just wanted to show it to you, and as we are doing it, you'll actually see for yourself, okay? So here are the actions for Lab 1 Part C, okay? We'll use MCC, we'll bring in the ADC and the PWM, Timer 2, and the UART, and then we'll set RA5 as the part, port in, RA3 as a PWM out, okay, RC0 as a UART, and RC1 as the RX, okay, RC, RA. And then we'll generate the code, okay? And then we'll, because of course we've added more peripherals now, obviously our state machines will increase. We have an ADC state machine, and we have the UART state machine to add. So I've written that new code for you in application header file as well as the application C file, and we'll add that to the system, and then we will build and then we'll run, okay? So let's go and do that. So get back to that here. And so we'll go back to MPLAB code configurator and go to resources. The first thing we're gonna do is to include our ADC. It's right at the top. Yeah. So we'll include our ADC. It'll take a little while. Yeah, here we are. So what we're gonna do here, the clock source is going to be the FRC. And instead of left justified, we're gonna choose right justified. That's all we have to do, Then the next thing we're going to do is to select timer 2. Timer 2 right here. All right. And in timer 2, we're going to select FOS divided by 4. Okay, and that's it. We're not enabling the timer, everything is done. So that's it. And finally, we go to the PWM. Okay, PWM right here. And we're going to take PWM 6, we're going to take. Okay, and that is already enabled and it's connected to timer 2. So we don't have to do anything. All of those peripherals are now included in our setup right here. Finally, we'll do the UART. UART right here. Okay. We'll include that. So here we include the transmit. The baud rate is 9600 baud, which we wanted. We'll enable the continuous receive and we'll redirect the standard I/O right here. Now, let's look at the pin grid manager, because remember, we've got to redirect the pins to certain things that we wanted. So let's look at that. All right. So the first thing is that we want to have PWM output on this particular pin right here, which is port A, bit number 3. That is, that LED is connected to that. We want to connect it there. Then we want to connect the ADC, or UART, okay. So the UART actually right now is connected to 7 and 6. So we'll disconnect that, okay, and connect it to 0 and 1 of port C. That's where we want to redirect it to. And finally, the pot. The pot is somewhere here, okay, right here, ADC pot. We want to connect it to right here. We want to connect it to the RA4. Okay. Okay. RA4 is where it's going to be connected to the pot. Okay. All right. So everything is done. All right. So let's go to the pin output, final pin module output, okay? Make sure that all of them are in the right place and given the right designators, rather. Here we are. All right. So I connected this to the wrong one. I beg your pardon. Let me redo that. I made a mistake there. Okay, so here we are. It's not the pot. Pot is not connected to that. Okay, it's connected to RA. This is RB. So RA4, right here. That's where it's connected. My bad. So if you connect it to, now if you look at the various channels, yeah, RA4. Is connected to the pot, so we'll call this pot right here, POT, okay, so that's got pot, that's an analog input, the PWM output is not an analog, it's digital, and then the transmit, which was reconnected to RC0, is digital also, and it's an output. So these are outputs, and so everything is set up correctly now. So we have the D2, which is our blinking LED from our old code, the pot, which is connected to RA4, and the S2, which is the switch, which is connected to the RA5, and then the transmit and receive of the UART is where it is right here, and the PWM output is to RA3, okay? So all that is done. We'll generate the code. It says there's a small conflict, but don't worry about that. We are saying, yes, we probably know about it. Okay. So it's completed. The generation is completed. So let's go to the project now. And remember, we've got to remove the old ones and add new ones. So we're going to remove from project app.h and app.c. Remove from project. Then we're going to go to the Explorer, and we're going to go to support and part C, and we're going to include these two files and say copy and include them in our lab and paste. Okay. So we copied the new files into our project, and now we've got to add them to our project. So we go back to our project, and in the header file, say add existing item, and add the header file. And then in the source, add the source file. Okay. Add the source file. Okay. With that being done, now the only thing that is left over is to add the functions. We've created the functions for the UART state machine and the ADC state machine. We've got to add that code into our main program. So we'll go to main, which is right here, okay? And we'll first initialize those state machines. So right here, we're going to initialize them. App ADC initialize. And then the next one is app UART initialize. Okay, and then write down in the main program, in the while loop, we'll write the tasks which are required, app ADC task, and then app UART task, the state machines for those two tasks that are at there. So with that, we've done everything that we had to do, and we will actually run the program right now. We'll clean and build. Okay. Okay, so it loaded up, everything worked out fine. So you can see that there's this other LED right there, which is glowing, and you can see as I turn the pot, it when I turn it to one direction, it goes off, and then when I turn it back on, it goes to full light. So it's actually doing the ADC function to it, okay? So let's look at the UART now. So I'll go to the Terra terminal, okay, and select the serial port, COM3, and say okay. And then if I press an H, it says hello world, and I say A, it says ADC. Let me change the value, and you can see as I change the value, a new ADC value is loaded onto it, okay? So both the UART as well as the PWM, everything works properly as we function. If we can go back and take a look at the code as to how we implemented the code. And here's what I did. If you look at the code now, okay, 1 minute. This may not be the right one. Okay, so app.c. And you can see that we had the old LED initialize and the S2 initialize. Okay, and then the task. So here we have the ADC tasks. So you can see the init tasks is there. Okay, which we initialized the hardware, we connected the channel to the pot, and we initialized the count. Remember, we're keeping a count of 16. That's the count that we keep, and the value, which is the ADC value, which is 0, and then we waited for the 16 conversions in the wait process. And when we are done with those 16, we loaded the PWM with the ADC value. As right here, you can see, I loaded PWM load duty cycle, ADC 16. And we averaged the ADC value by doing this shift right here. In the task for the UART, on the other hand, right here, okay, so the decoding is done right here. So when you see an H, you say hello world, and when you see an A, you print out a ADC value. That's the output that we wanted. Now in the task itself, in the UART task, we did a send. So if in case there's the TX buffer is free, we load a new value to it. And when you got a when you do a get, when the RCIF is free, then you load the receive register or the receive character. Remember the two characters that we are trying to receive, H and A. So those are received and then serially decoded right here, and then that function is done. Okay? All right. Okay, so when the USART is ready, it moves to the get task. All right. So that's all that was really there. And you know, you can write this code yourself also, but I saved you a lot of time by doing it myself and making it available for you. All right. So let's go back to our presentation. Yeah. All right. So to summarize what we did in Lab 1 Part C, we used MCC to configure the ADC, PWM, and UART. Okay. And so it was very simple. I mean, we didn't do too much at all. We just clicked a couple of buttons here and there to figure out what we are going to do, and that's all. All the code was generated by MCC for you. Okay. We used the peripheral pin select feature to redirect certain digital outputs to the right PWM for RA3 and the transmit and the receive for the UART. We added the state machines for the ADC and the UART, and we created and ran the project, and we can see that the project actually ran properly. Okay. So just to do a little bit of knowledge checks, MCC creates application code for you, code to initialize peripherals, code to use peripherals, all of the above. What do you think? No. It doesn't create application code. So this is a trick question. It is actually these two. So basically, it creates initialization and peripheral code, but doesn't create application. Unfortunately, application code has to be created by you. Okay. So state machine coding is easy to debug, easy to structure, easy to modify. I guess this one is four. You know, it's all of the above that we really need. Mm-hmm. So to summarize what we did today, we covered some PIX/Xchange architecture and the basics. Okay, we use MPLAB IDE to start and create a project from absolutely ground zero. We didn't do anything really there. Okay, we used state machines and we used MCC to create our coding. Okay, that's what we did, to initialize the peripherals as well as to get peripherals functions that we could utilize in our code. Okay, we use state machines in our code, which was the right way of doing it. Okay, so if you are doing an application, I really encourage you to do your application using state machine format. Use GPIO, ADC, PWM, and UART with the state machine code to do a simple application on a PIC16 F1 device today. Okay. So the related classes that we have, I've listed a lot of them. Some of you may have taken them, but they are related to the stuff that we are doing. Getting started with MPLAB X, you know, if you want to know how to use MPLAB X, you know, we just used it today, but there are a lot more features that are available on MPLAB X, which are very useful. C programming, if you want to be an expert on C, definitely that's a class to go. Details, more details on MCC, because I've always only covered a few of the peripherals today using MCC, but there are a lot more peripherals and functions available on MCC, and there are advanced classes on that. There's a class on embedded C, intermediate debugging, which is important if you have any problems in your code. Advanced debugging, this is also a very useful class. Besides that, we offer online classes. Besides masters, we also offer online classes. And you know, check on the on Microchip website for applications which are available. This particular board, MPLAB Express board, is actually with MPLAB Express IDE, which is a cloud-based application where you can actually do your application on the web. It may sound strange, but it's cloud-based, and you can use you can do this entire application, which I did today, on our MPLAB cloud-based Express location. Okay, so by all means, check that out, and you'll be able to use it. Okay, there's a developer's help. This is very useful, actually, for training material that you have whenever you need it. Okay, there's a website which is called the developer's website, and that offers you a lot of help and training to work with the different peripherals and microchip devices that we have right now. And the website for that is listed below here, Microchip Developers Help. Okay? This is what it looks like, the web page, and there are various applications that you can go to, and you know, see training, etc. A lot of the training, online training that we had, we've put on this website for you to utilize in and learn more to help you in your application. This is another screenshot, getting started with MPLAB XIDE and Microchip Tools. There's a whole class, and you can go through it on the web itself, and you can learn about it. So thank you very much for your attention today. Again, my name is Stan D'Souza, and thank you very much for attending, and I hope you learned something from our class today.